Hi, I'm Erik Walker, Vice President of Justinian and Associates. The president of the firm, Justinian Lane, has asked me to speak to you today on our firm's mass torts practice. In particular, where we file suit and why we file suit there. This is an important topic because of some United States Supreme Court decisions that were just issued over the last several months. Those decisions clearly indicate that the decision that we have made as to where to pursue litigation for our pharmaceutical clients, for all of our mass torts clients, have been the correct decisions. And the decisions made by our competitors have not been. And it's important for you to understand that and why that's the case. Before discussing that, though, I need to talk to you about the types of mass tort actions that exist. Essentially, a mass tort action is any kind of litigation that involves a large number of people suing over essentially the same thing. For instance, there may be an airline crash that involves 200 injured victims, and all 200 of them are suing about the same crash. Or there may be a drug that was released and that has injured several thousand people. Those are what we call mass tort actions because the lawsuits brought by those individuals will all essentially be dealing with the same subject matter. There are essentially three ways that you can pursue a mass tort action. And bear in mind that our firm handles mass tort actions in several areas, but we principally focus on pharmaceutical litigation. Litigation over drugs like Vioxx or Fen-Phen or antidepressants, transvaginal mesh, various treatments of different illnesses. If the drug is one that has caused a large number of injuries, chances are that we are pursuing litigation either on our own or in conjunction with other firms about those injuries. There are three kinds of ways that you can pursue litigation in pharmaceutical torts or any mass tort action. One is to file a class action. In a class action, one or more individuals file a lawsuit and then seek to represent all of the individuals nationwide or statewide that are part of the class of people that they represent. So, for instance, you might have two or three people injured by hormone replacement therapy that would file a lawsuit in which they seek class certification, meaning they want the judge to allow them to represent all of the individuals injured by hormone replacement therapy. Class actions are now generally disfavored in personal injury litigation. And the reason for that is based on the requirements for class actions. A class action requires that there be numerous plaintiffs with common claims. The plaintiffs wanting to represent the class have to be typical of the class members, and there has to be adequate representation. The attorneys involved have to have lots of experience representing classes, and they have to have adequate resources to pursue a class action suit. The problem in personal injury cases is this commonality requirement. The differences in the circumstances of each individual injured by a drug, for instance, mean that it is not worthwhile to pursue all of those claims in the same lawsuit. For instance, each individual will have different risk factors for an injury that may indicate whether or not the drug caused their injury or one of the risk factors they already had. You can imagine differences in people's smoking history, differences in their weight, differences in their age, differences in all sorts of risk factors will dictate how that individual reacts to a particular drug. And those differences will vary by individual to individual. It's therefore deemed not practical to try all of those personal injury suits in the same class because each plaintiff will be examined separately to determine what that plaintiff's damages are and the likelihood that plaintiff was injured by the drug. So class actions are essentially not allowed any longer for personal injury actions. There are some kinds of class actions allowed in pharmaceutical torts for things like medical monitoring, economic damages, but we're not going to get into those today. That will be the subject of future presentations. There are also two kinds of mass actions that you can file, and this is where lawyers representing pharmaceutical plaintiffs actually file lawsuits. There are federal MDL or federal multi-district litigation proceedings. We've talked about those before. I'm going to talk about them in a little more detail. And there are state consolidated proceedings. The difference in these two are federal MDL proceedings are filed in federal court, and state consolidated proceedings are filed in state court. I'm just trying to make sure my phone is turned off so I don't interrupt you all. Our firm files lawsuits principally in federal MDL proceedings, federal multi-district litigation proceedings. Many of the firms that we partner with and many of the firms that are competitors of ours choose to file lawsuits in state consolidated proceedings. The reason they choose to file in state proceedings is they have found that in certain regions of the country, the judges or the juries are more favorable to the plaintiff's side of the case or fairer to the plaintiffs than they are in others. For instance, if you go to St. Louis or if you go into Philadelphia, Pennsylvania or parts of New Jersey or parts of California, you find that you get jury pools that are sympathetic to injured consumers. Whereas if you've had a jury in perhaps somewhere like East or West Texas, you might have a more conservative jury that might not be as sympathetic toward an injured plaintiff. I'm being simplistic in isolating those regions in that fashion. The bottom line, though, is that lawyers have determined that there are certain state consolidated proceedings, certain places around the country where the jury pools or the judges or the law of that state are actually more favorable toward the plaintiffs than there are in other parts of the country. Our firm files principally in federal MDL proceedings as opposed to state court proceedings. And the reason, one of the principal reasons we do that is because we have been concerned for some time that these state court consolidated proceedings will be found not to have jurisdiction over the defendants being sued. And that's one thing I want to get into in a moment in more detail. In the federal MDL proceedings, as we've talked about before, what happens is this. You file a lawsuit either directly into the MDL court, or you file a lawsuit in the plaintiff's home state or the defendant's home state, and the lawsuit gets transferred to the MDL court for pretrial proceedings. All of the cases nationwide involving that subject matter get transferred to the same court for pretrial proceedings. That court then oversees discovery, oversees pretrial motion practices, essentially allows the parties to work the cases up for trial, to get them ready for trial, and then when the cases are ready for trial, the MDL court will send them back to the cases where they were originally filed or send them to the home state of the plaintiffs if the cases were directly filed into the MDL court. That's the way the MDL process works. With the state court consolidated proceedings, you would file a lawsuit in, say, St. Louis or in Pennsylvania, and everything would happen in Pennsylvania. Pretrial proceedings, trial, etc. The question is whether or not the courts in these state court consolidated proceedings have personal jurisdiction over the defendants.